Good evening, History of Christianity students. This is Doc Matthews again in the Shack of Knowledge. It's cold outside, but the fire is lit, and I have a hot beverage, and it's time to talk a little bit about the history of Christianity. This is the next lecture set after the discussion of early Christian worship. So just if things are on the page and you need to keep them in order as you're clicking on lectures, this one comes next in order after early Christian worship. In the second century, the Christian church faced the challenge of being noticed, is probably the best way to put it. At the turn of the second century, as we discussed, it's unlikely that there were more than about 8,000 Christians worldwide, and this can easily go under the radar of the empire. Local pockets of some sect of Jews that came to be called Christians were probably observed by the Roman authorities, but they didn't care too much. The persecution, more famous than it was widespread, that occurred in Rome under Nero, was possibly a persecution of a small group that had already been noticed in the 40s of a group of Jews that seemed to be following a group or following a person named Crestus. Sounds remarkably like Christus to me. And they split off from the main group of Jews, and it caused a big row in Rome. And this led to the Jews being evicted from Rome proper. They had to live in the outskirts after that. The Romans were very intolerant of spats among people who they thought should simply get along and enforce the Pax Romana among themselves. So with this possible early exception, really, there weren't enough Christians for anyone to take notice of, other than the neighboring Jewish communities, who probably didn't take a whole lot of notice of them either, other than to condemn them and move on with daily business. But in the second century, the movement began expanding, and there was a significant notice taken of Christians. In the textbook, the account of Pliny the Younger, sometime about 111, is recorded, where Pliny the Younger, at that time the governor of Bithynia, was reporting on the spread of the superstition of Christianity that had penetrated not only the cities but also the villages and country places. So it was small, but it was there. After torturing a couple of servant girls from a Christian household, Pliny reports to Emperor Trajan on this new movement. Oh, my fire's going crazy back there. I put a balsam log on, and that's like dropping fireworks on the fire. Pliny reports to the Emperor Trajan, yeah, the movement's out there, what should we do about it? And the answer is essentially nothing. It's not a threat. So we need to qualify some of the images we have of early Christianity. Christianity and the Roman government. Contrary to the lasting stereotype, persecution was not the official policy of Rome toward Christianity, except at the very end of the 3rd and very beginning of the 4th century. Even then, it could be argued, it wasn't official, it was just de facto. It was what the emperors did, not some absolute policy or law that had been passed that Christianity must be exterminated. Therefore, in the first centuries, persecution was neither complete nor widespread. Where it occurred, it was sporadic and local. Possibly the most famous case that comes down to us is the tradition of Nero burning Christians in Rome. How accurate that report is, I'm not sure. There was a certain elaboration in such histories. The idea that Nero may have targeted a small group of Jews that had become known as Christians by that time is not outrageous, though. There is a report already from the 40s, very shortly after the Jesus movement got going, of a group of Jews causing trouble in Rome because they followed a man named Crestus. Okay, there's a lot written on this on the internet. It's all garbage. That's all we know about it. There were a group of Jews who caused trouble within the Jewish community because they followed a man named Crestus. For this reason, because of the trouble within the community, all of the Jews in Rome were expelled. They had to live outside the city limits after that. It is possible, if you want to hypothesize for with something that will never be settled, it is entirely possible that this debate among Roman Jews, whether they should follow the man named Christus or not, led to the exile of certain Jews who met Paul and prompted then the letter to the Romans. You can look into that, and we can talk about it more in class if you're interested. But there's no way of being certain about that. It's just interesting to note the coincidences in times and places. Local governors could choose to appease popular dislike of Christians, if the local populace did dislike Christians, with capital punishment. The idea, as with the crucifixion of Christ, is that this would keep rioting down. I think that's a dubious policy. Tends to be when you make martyrs, you make followers of the martyrs. But be that as it may, this is how Rome thought of things. So it is possible, from place to place, if Christians were moving in, the local Jewish community might demand that that this is not true Judaism, and the Roman government should do something about it. It seems from the Book of Acts, though, that, at least from the author's point of view in the Book of Acts, the Jewish community tended to take care of these things themselves, you know, take care of the rival heretical Jews face-to-face, Jew-to-Jew. And this seems to be more typical, at least, if you take the position of the Book of Acts. Nevertheless, Christianity is not a licit religion. It is not a legal religion, and so it could be targeted by Roman authorities. What the public, or powerful individuals, often feared, and the Christian movement made them a bit nervous, was the Christian loyalty to a principality other than Rome first, this Kingdom of Heaven bit. And that seems to be what's going on in the letter from Pliny the Younger to Trajan. Perhaps more significant was the fear of certain powerful parties, and this I think is true especially in the second century, certain powerful parties and individuals that the new philosophy or religion was an element of unhealthy competition. You see this in the life of Justin Martyr, and we will be reading Justin very shortly in this class, so hold on to this idea, because Justin recounts in his second apology, which we'll be reading, several instances of the jealousy of a particular leader of a philosophical school toward Justin as competition. Eventually, it seems, that leader of a philosophical school, a chap by the name of Crescens, arranges to turn Justin in or demand that the Roman authorities settle this illegal religion that's being practiced next door and eliminate his competition. And with that, Justin, who was named the philosopher, is remembered as Justin the Martyr. No, his parents didn't name him Martyr with the high hopes of him making a splash. So, we do have several instances of that. That also happened, it appears, and we'll talk about this a little bit later still, it also appears that this happened with Irenaeus of Lugdunum, a place in Gaul that we now think of as Lyon, France. It seems that competition with kind of a Gnostic group, we'll talk about Gnosticism later, led the Gnostics to turn on and turn in their Christian neighbors, or their mainline Christian neighbors, and see to their deaths at the hands of the Roman authorities. One result of the infrequent and very local nature of the persecutions was that Christianity was never completely underground. These nifty 19th century images of Christians creeping around for fear of being caught and tortured to death by the Romans. Indeed, the Romans tended to torture people when they caught them doing something they thought was illegal. But there was no real effort to hunt out Christians. They tended to live fairly openly. Justin Martyr is a perfect example, completely openly, teaching in a catechetical school or lecturing on Christianity as a way of life right in Rome. So, unless they're causing trouble, Romans tended not to hunt folks down. If they wanted to hunt folks down, they probably could have done it. Another result was that it could never be completely stamped out, nor did the Romans want to. Once this became the policy of certain emperors, ooh, ouch, look at that punctuation, comma fault. Sorry about that, everybody. punctuation bothers me, but we're going to have to move on. Crisis, though, this is. Once this became the policy of certain emperors, Christianity was by then too powerful and widespread. But this was not for a couple of centuries yet after the second century, which is what we're talking about now. Yet another result was that Christianity obtained kind of a countercultural appeal. If people are looking for something that mom and dad aren't going to particularly like, I'm going to join a movement that really is a way of rebelling against authority. Well, look at this one. It preaches some interesting doctrines. It seems to advocate all the right Roman concepts of virtue and self-control. And it's pleasantly illegal. So, as happens everywhere, if something is not legal, it tends to attract a following. And that may well be with Christianity also. I think you'll see a certain sense of this when we, on the other side of the test, read the martyrdom of Perpetua and Felicitas, two young Roman women, one a noble, who is clearly rebelling against her father in joining the Christian movement. Finally, the fact that the persecutions weren't universal, it also produced the phenomenon of the apologists, very public individuals, who recognized that much of the antipathy toward Christians was based on lack of understanding. No, we don't truly drink blood. No, we don't eat a man's body in our midnight rituals. That's not what we do. That's the Eucharist, and we can explain it to you, but not in detail, because it's a mystery. It's a secret rite of ours. It is our most holy rite, but it involves bread and wine, not actual flesh and blood. Pliny and Trajan seem to be satisfied that the Christian movement wasn't, you know, plucking the odd Roman citizen off the street for a midnight meal of Roman citizen with side dishes. Once Christianity is more visible, it's faced with the challenge of its own identity. How do we define ourselves to the outside world so that they understand who we are, and for that matter, how do we define ourselves to ourselves in a formal way? When we talk to the increasing number of Christians in the second century, how do we recognize that this person is truly a Christian and that there are not, as the first century texts of the New Testament suggested, there are not other Christs and other movements being preached that take up the name? It appears in the first century, as we mentioned in the last lecture, that there really weren't a wide variety of Christianities. There's no evidence thereof at all. There weren't enough Christians for a wide variety of Christianities. All we have is the one group that denies the Ebionites, who deny the divinity of Christ, but that's the only thing that we can discern. Otherwise, this small group, only when it starts growing, do they have to face the question, how do we define ourselves to the outside, how do we explain who we are, and how do we define ourselves to ourselves so that we recognize one another when we meet in the various corners of the empire where we actually exist. So in the course of the second century, mainline Christianity was faced with the challenge of defining itself. By the way, although we don't know for sure, it's reasonable to suppose that by the second century there was also another group that had adopted Christian doctrines, and they will form into, in the course of the late first and second century, what we will call the Gnostics. So hold on to that thought, but having no evidence of the Gnostics other than some oblique discourse in the book of Colossians, and at that time it's not at all certain that these groups of Gnostics would have called themselves Christians. It was simply a package of ideas that the Apostle Paul posed. Just hold on to that idea. It may take time for the Gnostics to form up. There was a discernible mainline. There was a range of beliefs which were generally compatible and consistent with the Jewish origins and the first century transformation of those Jewish ideas that we've seen in the Gospel of Mark and in the Didache. So, hold on to this as well, because this mainline is going to have to maintain its sense of identity. The other groups will come and go. The textbook calls this discernible mainline the Catholic Church, with the word Catholic meaning universal, although the word Catholic actually refers to the chair that a bishop sits in, the Catholicos, And so I don't think it's the best term. I personally, and it shows my own biases, I suppose, but it also, I think, is more accurate according to language. Bart Ehrman calls this discernible early mainline kind of a proto-orthodoxy, a group of Christians that are still defining exactly where the boundaries are for their group, but which recognize one another as the mainline. The words come from the Greek ortho, as in orthodontist, when the guy puts your teeth right. Ortho means right or correct. Doxy is a little bit harder to define because we aren't at all certain how the word developed, but it could come from worship, doxazo, so these are the groups that worship correctly, or it could also come from right teaching or belief, from dokeo, I teach, or I instruct. To be fair, in the thinking of the second century, you could not separate the style of worship from the teaching. One was public words, the other was public actions, and if your words and actions contradict, or if your actions do not reflect the truth of your words, then you're a hypocrite. So the concept of worshiping the right way and teaching the right way were completely united. There is a variation among both worship and teaching, even within the proto-Orthodox mainline, but both worship and teaching were formal and ritualized, and both had to agree and follow tradition. There was no particular creative worship movement in the early church. The idea was to maintain that which had been handed down, the paradosis, that which is handed over, or the tradition. We need maybe to talk about tradition in class, so as I said with the last lecture, I hope you have notepaper beside you and are marshaling all your questions to assail me in class. You know, that's the part of class that I most enjoy, and taking role, probably the class, part of class that I enjoy least. You all have nice names, but it's embarrassing mispronouncing them. Three elements were necessary for defining the mainstream. The first is that there were centers where it was clear that the apostles had been, or that the apostles had left their followers to maintain the tradition which they had preached themselves. This is the first concept of apostolic succession. It develops into something more in both the Orthodox and Roman Catholic churches, and to some degree it's right and wrong the directions it takes later. But in the early years of Christianity, at what Irenaeus will refer to you when you read Irenaeus as the apostolic succession, is the sense that apostles planted themselves in certain places for a while, planted their own disciples and followers there, and that these centers of apostolic activity are the places you look to find authentic Christianity. So you have to look to Antioch to see where they were first called Christians, what this very early Christian community held and taught. Jerusalem, obviously, being another, Alexandria being another, and there, of course, are several important ones in Asia Minor. The second element that is essential for defining the mainstream in the second century is the evolution of creeds, or canoni. Canon, we've talked a little bit about in class, is a rule or a guideline. It is not a law, and the creeds were canons. They were rules of faith. Lists of words, patterns of words that would be memorized before a person was baptized in the second century and following, and in memorizing them and learning the explanation of them, the catechumens, the people entering Christianity, would know what their faith essentially was, and they could measure what others were saying according to this pattern of words, the creed. Creed from the word credo, I believe, that's the first words that start the creed, or we believe, is typical in some places and in some times. But this is what's going on. It amuses me more than a little bit to hear folks say, well, I believe in the Bible, I don't need a creed. Actually, the creeds existed before your canon of scriptures was recognized as a universal authority. What do people use as their authority, as their measure of true Christianity versus some other things that might be said around them? They would use their rule of faith, or this short, almost poetic passage that they would memorize, which was the creed. And finally, there's another rule that develops over time, and we'll talk about this as well, the rule or the canon of the New Testament scriptures. This is not always and everywhere the same. The New Testament scriptures read are the what we would think of as scriptures in our reasoning that were read in Alexandria were very different from the scriptures read in Antioch. They were not, sorry Dan Brown, they were not contradictory. But what you do have is a different list. The Didache is in some lists, but not others. The book of First Clement is in some lists and not others in the early church as an authoritative book. Shepherd of Hermas, another book you don't have in your New Testament, was widely read as an authoritative or an official book. So we'll talk about this and how the early concept of forming a group of authoritative texts develops in the second century. But to put a fine point on it, folks, you're living in a world where you're going to have a lot of folks telling you that the Bible comes from the first century. Essentially, the teachings and all or most, depending on how you debate it, of the texts in the New Testament come from the first century, but there is no such thing as a New Testament in the early church. We'll talk about that more, and again, do ask about these things, because I enjoy it. Historically, and I want to be clear on this as well, you cannot have one without the other two. The three develop as three rules or guidelines for establishing mainline Christianity, for establishing proto-orthodoxy. Those who say today that I have the Bible, I don't need creeds, and I don't need any tradition, okay, that's interesting, but in the early church they would have looked at you like you have no business wandering into the church building. If you say, well, since there was no New Testament, they just went on oral authority, well, that's silly as well. This concept of the texts, which could be traced to the apostles and their followers, was developing rapidly as a way of combating bad ideas that were developing in the second century. Bad ideas, of course, according to the proto-Orthodox, the Christian mainstream. Let's talk about some of those challengers or the bad ideas according to the Christian mainstream. The second century was critical for establishing a widespread, if not quite universal, definition of what true Christianity was. None of the three developments we talked about on the last slide, none of the three developments required for this would have emerged if it had not been for a challenge issued by rival Christianities. The second century is where these rivals take off, not the first. The largest of the rivals were still extreme minorities, even within the tiny Christian movement. They were just a few people, folks. But the mainstream of the however many thousand Christians that existed, the mainstream considered them a serious challenge. The biggest, at least the most noteworthy, by the 4th century is Gnosticism, and we'll take some time to talk on that much later. Another and more mainstream-ish movement than Gnosticism, which is the greatest outlier, is Marcion and the Marcionites, but still not, discernibly not part of the Christian tradition in as we've learned it from the 1st century. Montanism is probably the closest you're going to find to the Proto-Orthodox, and the Montanists and the Proto-Orthodox in certain places like North Africa would be almost indiscernible from one another until they really started getting into some heated debates. Another second century development, by the way, Montanism. Only in response to these developments, these rivals to the mainstream, did the mainstream develop a clearly articulate summary of faith, the creeds. Only in response to these did the mainstream demand that all teaching be in conformity with the tradition established in the first century, meaning a formal concept of apostolic succession. Is the teaching of the apostles clear here, as measured by the traditional centers of Christianity? And only in response to these did they develop, very informally, a list of books which were the real authorities in matters of Christian teaching, or an early canon of what would eventually be called the New Testament. That's right, I want to put a fine point on this. Without heresies, there would be no Bible as you know it. the concept of developing an authoritative list, such as there was already in existence of the Old Testament books, or a couple of lists of the Old Testament books, that concept develops as a reaction against Marcion and the Marcionites particularly, but you can see it in discussions of all three of these central groups of heresy. We will circle around at the end of this cycle of lectures back to Gnosticism when we talk about the apologist known as Irenaeus of Lyon or Irenaeus of Lugdunum. But I do want to just outline what Gnosticism was to start, since it existed prior to Christianity and insinuated itself into the Christian movement by the time of Irenaeus. However that occurred is a matter of debate, but it did in fact happen that way. It comes from the Greek, the root word comes from the Greek gnosis, which means to know. It's a knowing, or it's a knowledge. Gnosis actually means knowledge. Gnostics believed they had a special knowledge of divine things. You may know, but we have a secret knowledge. And when we read at the very end of this section of the course, when we read actual Gnostic writings, this is one of the key features that just comes jumping out at you. The texts of the Gnostics always have a secret that's not known to the mainline followers of Christ or the mainline community in which they operate. They constituted a separate movement which existed both outside of, that is before, and within Judaism and Christianity. Well, whether they existed before Judaism is debatable, I suspect not really, but they certainly existed before and within Judaism and Christianity. So people would have kind of secret societies of the ones who know the inner truths, the inner secrets, and these would form like little nodules within Jewish and Christian communities. They were syncretistic. Syncretism is borrowing and incorporating ideas from different religions and philosophies. They were syncretistic. The Gnostics borrowed from and blended a wide variety of thought into a variety of consistent systems, which all shared some common points. And so, whether they're Jewish Gnosticism or Christian Gnosticism or just kind of general Gnosticism, they all kind of look like this when you read the writings. They are dualistic. Christianity and Judaism are not dualistic. They believed, the Gnostics believed, the universe is divided into good and evil forces, which are at odds with each other. For Jews and Christians, there is a good force, God, and there is a non-rival, failed evil force, sometimes personified as in the book of Job, with this kind of evil one or Satan character. But there's no dualism. There's no cosmic warfare between good and evil, light and dark. There's no wrestling match between the devil and Jesus to see who wins the soul of the world. That makes for great movies, but that has nothing to do with Christianity or Judaism. The Gnostics viewed the material world as being inferior, and safe to say, most of them, I think, from what the texts say, most of them thought the material world was not just inferior, but actually evil. Matter is evil. The material world is evil. Again, this is an image which has been constructed or applied to Christianity and even Judaism, the idea that the material world is evil, Judaism not nearly so much as Christianity, but those are not Jewish and Christian ideas. That is a Gnostic idea. The material world is good for Jews and Christians because God made it, and God made it good. The fact that it gets twisted or perverted, and that twisting or perversion is the very definition of evil in Hellenistic Judaism and Christianity, that's not God's fault. The material world is a good thing and must be enjoyed and celebrated. Gnostics see the material world as an evil thing, which, as we'll see, is something one must escape. So the escape of the material world is one key element of Gnosticism. The human body, being a material and imperfect or even evil thing, and the human body and its appearance, form, everything about the human body, was at best a shell which contained the Gnostic soul. The Gnostic soul was the individual which simply lived in a body. The body was not part of the individual proper. I want to make this clear because this is another idea which gets ascribed to Judaism and Christianity, the idea that somehow the body is just a shell. Hamlet brings this up of all people. Well, of course, he didn't exist, but Shakespeare, or whoever wrote Shakespeare, brings this up in regard to Hamlet. I put that in there just to annoy my English department colleagues, by the way. Shakespeare puts into the mouth of Hamlet this concept of shuffling off the mortal coil, as if, you know, the body is just a suit of clothes which may be left behind. This is not a Christian idea. This is not a Jewish idea. The human body is a part of the individual's identity for both Jews and Christians, and this is a profound reason why we have to focus on the material side of Christianity to understand it. Why do they bury people close to their homes? Because these people's bodies are part of them. Why do Jews, not nearly as vehemently or overtly as Christians, why do Jews reverence the places where the bodies rest? Because this is where that part of the person is. For Gnostics, heck, the body's just a suit of clothes. Take it off, leave it, your soul goes wandering on its merry way back to Gnosticville. The Gnostics form, in their own minds, an elite clique. They are the ones who are aware of the real state of things. Everybody else is ignorant. We're going to see this big time when we read Irenaeus of Lyon. He despises this feature of the Gnostics, this aspect of we are superior to everyone else, and there's nothing the everyone else can do about it. It's a little bit, the emotions run pretty high in Irenaeus. It's a little bit like I remember feeling, knowing I would never be in the in crowd in high school. Probably the best thing that ever happened to me in retrospect. But it still was a resentment toward those who were the in crowd. Why do you get to be the in crowd? Well, because we have the secret knowledge. We know fashion, we know music, and you don't. So, yeah, without dredging up too much of my miserable past, the Gnostics have this same type of elitism that many of us remember from high school, or even, you know, possibly more profoundly, middle school. And they operate that way within the communities that they infiltrate, and that's an important thing to know. Did they see themselves this way, or is Irenaeus just being a bit pissy about the whole issue of Gnostics and how they relate to his own community? Well, I'll let you decide when you read the texts. My answer is, my goodness, yes, they are a bunch of elitist snobs. But, hey, I don't want to prejudice your judgment, although I just have. Decide for yourself. We'll be reading the Gospel of Judas and the Apocalypse of Peter, two particularly lovely Gnostic samples, very shortly. The Gnostics often saw themselves as being eternal sparks or fragments of the divine, little divine beings scattered and imprisoned in the nasty and evil material world, and their goal was to get back. Their goal was to get back to the spiritual world where they truly belonged, leaving the evil material world behind. For the Gnostics, those who were not Gnostics were inherently inferior and not capable of the salvation which comes when the spirit is released from the material body. This gets challenged occasionally by folks who say, oh yes, that's just another bias of the bishop Irenaeus of Lyon, but again, I'll let you decide for yourself when you read the Gnostic texts. To me, it seems like that judgment's pretty darn accurate. These are a bunch of really nasty snobs when it comes to it. You're not going to be saved, but we are. You're not capable of salvation. You're an inferior class of human being. Too bad for you. You will deal with the consequences, but we will move on to the Gnostic bliss. The existence of Gnosticism set up a situation in which the Gnostics saw themselves bound to a separate moral code. The Gnostics, seeing the material world as evil, and yet believing themselves to be hidden or secret within this evil material world, could deal with the material world in two ways. Some Gnostics, much like we've seen among the Stoics and Epicureans, saw virtue in rejecting the pleasures of the world entirely, Epicureans particularly, counter to the image. That was this reaction of Gnostics was probably the most widespread, surprisingly, since the other option often looks much more attractive to us, to me, to be honest. Others indulged in them as much as possible, since, hey, the material world is evil, your body's evil, evil can just do what it wants and it's going to pass away anyway, so eat, drink, and be merry. Behavior in this life didn't matter, all that mattered was your Gnostic soul, enjoy it to the full. Strangely, from what we can tell, and that's there's a lot of debate on this too, but it certainly seems like the category of Gnostics that rejected the pleasures of the world entirely were the more widespread and popular. Darn. Go figure. According to their critics, principally Irenaeus of Lyon, but he is certainly not alone, their elite status meant that they would willingly lie, defraud, or betray others, so long as no Gnostics were harmed by the action. Since other human beings are inherently inferior, throw them under the bus. If the local Roman authority says we're not going to tolerate Christianity anymore, the Gnostics will say, well, that's good to hear, because we're not truly Christians. But these people are. And they would turn in their neighbors. This is described in some detail by Irenaeus of Lyon, and we will talk about it further when we read his first book, Against Heresies, a little bit later. But it also seems to be the case with Irenaeus himself. He seems to have been turned in to his death by the local Gnostics. Again, more on this later. So, there's a strange phenomenon in our culture, I'll be honest, I don't understand it one bit, that when people tired of the various various forms of Christianity which have come down and determined themselves to be traditional, in the late 20th century or even in the early 20th century, there was a gravitation toward the Gnostic writings. Ooh, the secret writings of the Gnostics, true Christianity, the Christianity that is hidden within the texts of the scriptures, the Christianity that only the enlightened can know. And it's even been described in the late 20th century as a more egalitarian, open, people-friendly Christianity. I don't get that at all. Read the texts. In fact, I know some Gnostics. I know a Gnostic priest who is very proud of his Gnosticism. I know some Gnostic monks who are very proud of their Gnosticism. They aren't bad people. But it's clear I'm not one of them. And it's clear they look down on me. Hey, that's part of the Gnostic creed. Who can blame them? They adopted the creed, which is what they wanted in the first place to, I think, to set themselves apart as an elite. So I just don't get, pay attention because it's out there, but I just don't get folks who talk about Gnostics as some type of egalitarian love group, kind of the hippie communal answer to Christianity. They weren't that at all. I always have to give my usual warning when I'm doing these pre-recorded lectures that I am generalizing more than I like, but in a class that surveys so many topics, generalizations have to occur. It's the only way to teach. Feel free to ask about specifics, because I spent a large part of my life reading actual Gnostic literature and reading the responses to Gnostic literature in the early church. So keep in mind, these are generalizations, always the caveat that has to be somewhere in my lecture. But as with all forms of Gnosticism, we now know a lot more about Christian Gnosticism because recent finds of texts, particularly at Nag Hammadi, and we can talk about what Nag Hammadi was a bit later, have given us much better understanding of the Gnostic movements than we had before. We have found large pockets, in other words, of their actual texts, as opposed to just what Irenaeus and Eusebius and others who have been labeled heresiologists, the students of heresies, Christian writers who described what these heresies were, had one view of Gnosticism. But now with the actual writings, with many texts of the actual writings of the Gnostics, we can say, okay, are Eusebius and Irenaeus being accurate? Or is there a different way to understand Gnosticism? Among other things, we now know that Gnosticism didn't grow directly out of early Christianity, but it added Christian features to its pre-existing systems. So Gnostics existed, and they picked up on a lot of Christian ideas early on. Irenaeus suggests that Gnosticism grew directly out of Christianity as an aberrant or a wayward group. Well, that isn't quite the way it happened, and the texts bear witness that there was a pre-Christian Gnosticism that adopted Christian ideas in various places, as the forms of Gnosticism always kept changing from place to place. Apparently, many Gnostics were sincerely attracted to the new Christian movement, because the Christ figure could easily be adapted to Gnostic mythology. You're going to be reading some of this mythology in your own time, but let's just outline it here. In Christian forms of Gnosticism, the Jewish Old Testament God, or the Jewish God of the Old Testament, was an inferior God, maybe confused, or possibly an evil God that had to be overcome. You'll see that in the Gospel of Judas, particularly. The Gnostic texts, or the Gnostic Christian texts, presented Christ not as human, but as a purely divine or spiritual presence, representative of the transcendent realm, who was sent to deliver a small group of people, the Gnostics themselves. He wasn't sent to save humanity or to save the world. He was sent to deliver a very small group of people, the Gnostics themselves, from the material world, where they had been trapped. The regular Christians, according to Gnostic Christianity, were deluded into thinking that there was a continuity with the Jewish Old Testament, when Christ's secret teachings revealed that he had come to overthrow the Jewish system. Think what this means about my interpretation of the Gospel of Mark, and we can put some ideas together here. The Gnostics, who became the core of the Gnostic Christian movements, saw the Old Testament God as evil, and saw the mainline Christians, who used the basic texts of Christianity at face value, texts like the Gospels of Mark and Matthew, for instance, they said that the image that the Old Testament God is the same as Christ is a fantasy. But it's a fantasy that no one could get out of the texts themselves, since that's what they seem to say. You have to know the secret teachings, which are only passed quietly, in dark alleys, I guess, among the Gnostics themselves. And when you know those, you realize that Christ had actually come to overthrow the Jewish system. Think of this again in terms of what I've said about anti-Semitic developments in New Testament scholarship. I'm particularly concerned with certain offshoots of the Tübingen school that I've mentioned in class, who see Christianity, early Christianity, as a rebellion against Judaism rather than an outgrowth of Judaism. It bothers me at a number of levels because this interpretation it's not native to the mainline Christian texts. It's an interpretation which reflects Gnosticism or some type of secret knowledge which would lead that way. Let's talk on that further in class because I think this type of interpretation of text leads to some good discussion of how we use historical sources. The secret teachings of Christ were revealed to some of the apostles, but were preserved in a tradition known only to the Gnostics themselves, though certain hidden truths could be allegorically found in the New Testament if you knew how to read through all the other garbage in the New Testament to see the secrets hidden therein. Kind of a hidden Bible code. Have we heard about those from time to time in the tabloids? I think it's a recurring theme over a couple thousand years. Note what this means. The Gnostics have a strong sense of a secret tradition which runs alongside the mainline tradition. The reaction of the mainline is to emphasize their own tradition as it's been handed down to them. Hence the concept of apostolic succession and apostolic authority. Gnostics often formed their own rival bodies and institutions, but they were also found hiding in with and under, if you like, the Christian churches, a secret community within the local parish. That's kind of, among Christian communities today, that's always every pastor's nightmare. There's a secret community that's operating differently and willing to overthrow the mainline. while that may seem paranoia today, it was actually accurate when the Gnostic communities were existing within mainline Christian communities. There's also a branch of scholarship that suggests that the Gnostics were simply varieties of the same or indiscernible from the mainline. Again, I'll let you be the judge in comparing what they write with what you've already written in mainline writings such as the Gospel of Mark, or what you've already read in mainline writings such as the Gospel of Mark and the Didache. We have good evidence that regular Christians were seen as a lower class of people who could be betrayed to the authorities in times of persecution, while Gnostics would freely deny Christ to the authorities. After reading Justin, you can see where this would not be appreciated by mainline Christians. So hold on to that thought. How Christians saw the concept of denial or betrayal is important. To deny Christ is to reject the full package. Is there forgiveness after openly denying Christ when you're called to account? Probably not. Say an awful lot, probably the majority of this mainline Christian or proto-Orthodox group. The second significant group of challengers that we'll be considering in this course is the followers of Marcion, or Marcion and those who agreed with him in his particular interpretation of Christianity. The dog believes there are wolves on the property, or at least the dog wants to put up a good show of protecting me. So if you hear her barking in the background, that's what's going on. I'll let her and the wolves sort it out. We'll talk about Marcion and his followers. Marcion was born probably prior to the turn of the 2nd century, 80 or 90 CE, and he died about the year 154. He went to Rome about the year 140 and was shortly excommunicated from the Church of Rome in July of 144, so 4 years, and then they said, okay, no more, we're not putting up with this fellow any longer. It may have taken him a while to present his own views, but once he did, he was asked to leave the Christian community. We no longer have his own writings, but there is a fairly consistent picture which emerges from the writings of his opponents who were in the mainstream. Probably he wasn't a Gnostic from the way he's described, but there are definitely clear parallels to the movement that we just described in the last two slides. First of all, he rejected the God of the Old Testament. The real God of the New Testament was the only being worthy of the name God. The God of the Old Testament was evil and petty and created the material world, which was also evil. Creation was evil. And so delivering you from this nasty God of the Old Testament was the person of Jesus, who was the real God, come in secret to rescue folks from the Old Testament God. As a result of not liking the material world, Marcion and his followers rejected materialism, including sex. Rejecting all forms of sex at all times is a good way to shorten the life of your movement, because it also shortens the probability, or it also lowers the probability of having children born into the movement. But in Marcion's case, this was simply a part of rejecting the material world. Mainline Christians had a context in which sex was encouraged, namely marriage. Marcion believed that marriage, being an institution of the Old Testament God, was as evil as everything else. Marcion and his followers regarded Christ as the deliverer from the creation of the Old Testament God, freeing you from the nasty material world. Debates continue over possible influence of Marcionites upon Christian Gnosticism or of Gnosticism upon Marcion, and they will never be resolved because we just don't have the evidence to do so. Give scholars something to do in their spare time, I guess. Marcion developed a radical interpretation of the writings of Paul. You'd have to reject completely the God of the Old Testament, and of certain sections of the Gospel of Luke, in which the message of Christ is presented as a clear rejection of the Jewish God. In other words, he cut and pasted from the Christian text that he received. Of course, he couldn't use Matthew, which focuses heavily on the goodness of the Old Testament God. Marcion cut and pasted some of the, not literally, by the way, you wouldn't do that to a papyrus scroll. I'm being figurative. he took what he liked and left what he didn't from the writings of Paul and the Gospel of Luke, and presented Christ as antithetical, an opponent of the Old Testament God. Marcion's list of true scriptures, the ones that are acceptable, or true scriptural sections pertaining to the Christ, is really the first canon of the New Testament, the first list of authoritative books. In other words, the first person to develop a list that might be called a New Testament is the heretic Marcion. Think about that. His canon contained edited versions of 10 letters of Paul and a heavily abridged version of the Gospel of Luke, in which the Old Testament God again was made to look like a bad guy. Marcion's followers formed a small but significant rival church, which was particularly strong in parts of Syria, lasting there, it seems, until the 5th century, which puzzles me, since they're not having sex, or at least not officially having sex, but they managed to linger as a small group in parts of Syria into the 5th century. Marcion's book, now lost, was called Antitheses, or Oppositions, I guess you could call it. The Book of Oppositions set forth the specific doctrines that Marcion rejected from mainline Christian teaching. Hold on to this thought, because when Christians start stating what they believe, they don't call it antitheses, they state it positively. This is what we believe, the creeds. We believe, not we reject. This is an important difference that will last into our discussions of the 4th century and the development of the Great Creed of Nicaea/Constantinople. The last of the three big challengers to mainline Christianity in the 2nd century doesn't come till the real end of the 2nd century, but it's probably the greatest competition because of the significant overlap in teachings with mainline Christianity. Unlike Gnosticism and Marcionites, the Montanists were genuine believers in the teachings of the early Christian church, but they also believed that these teachings weren't complete until their own movement came onto the scene, and that's what makes them not the mainline. They are named after Montanus, a fellow who began preaching about the year 170, known by its adherence as the New Prophecy. They didn't obviously call themselves Montanists. That would be a bit rich, especially for Montanus himself. They called themselves the New Prophecy because the leaders, Montanus and his female associates Priscilla and Maximilla, genuine female clergy, if you're looking for them in the early church, they're to be found among the Montanists. They claimed to have received a new revelation from God, which superseded or perhaps completed the New Testament. So there is the New Testament, and that's all well and good, but there's more to be said, and that revelation came through Montanus and Priscilla and Maximilla. This new revelation was the key to interpreting the true meaning of many passages of the Scriptures. In other words, there's a certain Gnostic-like tendency in the New Prophecy movement, because there is a secret wisdom in the Scriptures which can only be understood with the use of the New Prophecy. How large a feature this was of Montanism is a debatable thing, and we'll raise that again when we talk about the church in Carthage and the possibility that Perpetuel and Felicitas were fringe Christians, or perhaps adherents to Montanism. I don't believe they were, but certainly Tertullian, the church father, was, and we know a lot about the movement from him, an actual adherent who wrote a great deal, probably the most prolific writer in the Latin language for the first up until well into the 4th century, in the Christian movement, that is. The Montanists predicted the imminent end of the world. The end is right around the corner. Now, what date is that? Oh, it's happening soon. It's going to happen in 223. It's going to happen in 250. I don't know what the dates were, but they always seem to be conveniently flexible. When you said, okay, the end of the world's getting closer, it's happening very quickly, here it comes, year 223, and now it turns year 224, or, of course, they're using the Roman calendar. they say, well, we really meant this date. That also happens with movements, as you may know, predicting the end of the world today. They predicted the end of the world in 2012, it didn't happen. They predicted the end of the world in 1999, it didn't happen. So you keep adjusting the goalposts until you find the actual end of the world, I guess. So there you have it. The Montanists were among the first to pull that trick. They practiced a much more rigorous ascetic discipline than proto-Orthodoxy. They were much harsher in how they treated their own behaviors and control of the passions. They had more and far longer fasts, just to discipline the body and the spirit. You're fasting from a lot more things for a lot longer. They discouraged marriage, because why get married when the end of the world is coming? They advocated, much like the Epicureans, you could think, the severing of worldly ties in preparation for the end. Maybe there's some overlap with the Epicureans, or maybe it's just the natural result of a doctrine that says the world's ending soon, so don't be putting down roots. For the Montanists, martyrdom was not to be avoided and was even to be sought out. If there's a persecution, go find a way to make sure that you get to be martyred. This was considered ridiculous by the main line. If martyrdom happens to you, you accept it, but you wouldn't go say, oh, hey, there's martyrs being made in Carthage, let's go join. You receive it as God gives it. You don't go hunting it out. God also gives life, and you don't despise that gift, is the response of the main line to the Montanists. They weren't the only ones criticized for this. There seems to be kind of a morbid love of martyrdom in various corners of the Christian movement. Later on, you'll hear about another group called the Donatists that has the same tendency. But here you have it in the second century among the Montanists. Very quickly, the Montanists, because, of course, they rejected anyone who didn't accept their new prophecy, very quickly they formed a separate rival church, which, though never large, made a significant number of converts early on. The most significant convert was, of course, Tertullian. The Montanists probably had female clergy. I don't see any other way to interpret that. I accept that mainline Christianity had female deacons, but we don't have any evidence of anything equivalent to a female bishop, except in kind of an imaginary rewrite of some catacomb paintings that take a beardless guy and I think turn him into a girl. That kind of Dan Brownish move I don't regard as legitimate scholarship. But the Montanists, especially as a result of their focus on Priscilla and Maximilla, it seems like they truly had a female clergy, which would have functioned just like the male bishops and presbyters and deacons that you see in mainline Christianity. They dwindled out of existence in the early 4th century. Wanting to die in persecutions tends to shorten the lifespan of a movement. They were possibly wiped out in the last persecutions of the 4th century. That's hard to say, but there's not much discussion of them after that. And again, I guess I said this earlier, but Tertullian was its most significant convert. And what this means is that when we're reading the writings of Tertullian, which are a lot of writings, he gives us a wonderful insight into early Christianity, especially in North Africa. But the early writings, where he is not yet a Montanist, are always considered a little bit better or more authoritative among Christian communities than the later writings, because, of course, in the later writings, he had become a Montanist, and now he's giving us a clear insight into the Montanist movement, not just Christianity, but this particular branch that followed these doctrines. So now let's talk about the response, because the response has ramifications which last far longer than the original heresies, as they come to be called. While a range of opinions was definitely tolerated within the emerging proto-Orthodox mainstream, the teachings of Marcion, the Gnostics, and the Montanists were widely, pretty well universally held by the mainstream to have crossed the boundaries out of authentic Christianity into something else. Hence, they came to be called heretics. Now, this is a word which is used a lot by people who have no idea what it means. So let's find out what it means, and then we can talk about how it can really properly be used when we see one another again in the discussion in class. It comes from the Greek aretizo, which means I choose. I keep turning words into the infinitive. For those of you who are bothered by such grammar, I apologize. But aretizo actually means I choose, and of course, I put it there as if it means to choose. Well, I know. I have something of an obsession with such things. Heretics, then, are those who choose to follow their own ideas or who choose their own way over the teachings and tradition of the original or genuine church as the proto-Orthodox thought of themselves. Heretics, then, you cannot be a heretic if you do not emerge out of or if you do not relate to officially the Christian religion. For instance, Jews are not heretics. To the Jews, Christians are heretics because they emerged out of the Jewish movement and took their own path. To Christians, pagans are not heretics, they're pagans. That's how they get the name eventually over time. Not the name pagan, which isn't even an ancient name. But the idea that you're choosing something from within the religion and excluding other things, or you're choosing your own ideas and still claiming to be part of the movement, you can't be a heretic if you don't claim to be part of the movement. Okay? So if you're not a Christian, you're not a heretic. I have several atheist friends who say, well, Christians regard me as a heretic. No, they regard you as an atheist, which is what you regard yourself as. You can only be a heretic if you are first a Christian or claim to be a Christian and choose a direction that is not acceptable to the mainline. That's what it means. I want to be clear on that because I really get tired of that word getting thrown around. Martin Luther could be considered a heretic by the Catholic Church when he rebels against certain aspects of Roman Catholic doctrine and discourse. But somebody like Benedict Spinoza, who was a Jew, could not be considered a heretic by the Church because he was never a Christian. There you have it. In making this choice, the heretics have chosen to depart from the main Christian community, and it is their choice to depart. That's why they choose to follow a different or a false teaching. Heretic can only be applied to those who claim to be Christians, not to Jews or pagans, etc., which is what I was mentioning earlier, and forgot I had written on this slide already, or I wouldn't have said it twice. Somehow the boundaries of the faith had to be clearly established in the minds of the leaders of the proto-Orthodox. We have to give our people a clear sense of what the differences are. Three routes were taken simultaneously, and they were probably not even considered three routes. It's just how we look back at it as historians. The first is the concept of the original tradition. Now, tradition has been, the idea of tradition as being an essential defining feature of the faith can be found throughout the first century writings. We saw it in the Didache. It figures prominently in the Gospel of Mark and the writings of Paul. But tradition itself takes on kind of a more intense meaning in the context of the debates with the heretics. Over against the Gnostic claim to have the secret traditions of the real Christ, and the claims of Marcion and the Montanists to have the true interpretation of scriptural writings as opposed to the false one of the mainline Christians, the true tradition of the apostles' teaching had to be identified as it was carried out in the various local churches established by the apostles. We'll talk on this a bit more, but that gives you a sense of where we're going. The other thing that develops are creeds, which are concise and formal statements or formulas of belief which stated in a positive sense the teachings of the regional mainline churches and excluded contrary teachings by simply not sanctioning them. They never denounced contrary teachings. They simply stated in a positive sense that which is acceptable. Gerald Bray, the Anglican theologian, who taught at a school I once attended in Southgate, a suburb in North London, Oak Hill College, had a pretty good way of summarizing it. staking out the boundaries of the faith. That's what creeds do. It's not that you can't believe anything else, but that if you don't believe this, it's kind of a mere Christianity, a baseline for what true Christianity is. If you don't believe this, then you're not truly Christian. And this way, Christians from different communities could measure one another according to their creeds, their statements of belief. What do you believe? And they would respond. This is particularly valuable as Christians move from place to place. If you move from the community in Rome to the community in Carthage, the community in the Carthage has the right to ask you what you believe, and then you would give them, from memory, your formal statement of faith. They could measure you and say, are you or are you not a Christian? And they would measure it against their own claim or statement of faith, their own creed. We'll talk about what a creed is a bit more, of course, again. Frequently, that concept of movement also carried a letter, if the papyrus and the literacy were available, so that you could have an actual certificate relating to your identity within the Orthodox proto-Orthodox movement. And then the final response was the development of an official list, or actually many official lists, of true authoritative books, over against the list of acceptable or authoritative writings forwarded by Marcion or the Gnostics. The proto-Orthodox developed their own list, which would come to form eventually, and never officially, it was just a gradual development, which would come to form the New Testament as we have it today. Among the proto-Orthodox responses, which elicits probably the most discussion, and I look forward to it when I see you in class, is the concept of tradition. And this is because the word has come to take on a very negative meaning, particularly among certain modern Christian groups. Contrary to the assumptions of many modern Christians, though, in the second century, it was not possible to go to the Bible to find out what the original teachings of Christianity were. There's a good reason for this. The part of the Bible dealing with Jesus Christ, the New Testament, had not been established as an authority yet. There are some people who misunderstand this little bit of history and suggest that the books of the New Testament hadn't been written yet. That's nonsense. The books of the New Testament had mostly been written in the first century. You could make the argument that all had been written in the first century, and there are scholars who would back you up on that. But these writings simply hadn't been collected and understood as some type of universal authority at this point. The response to the developments of the heresies was first to look at the most traditional communities, those which were large and had clearly been established by the original apostles. Apostles means the ones that are sent out by Jesus to teach. It refers principally to the 12 followers minus Judas, with the addition of Matthias, and with the addition of Paul as a 13th, if you like. Number of 12 is just relative. But these are the ones that are originally or directly sent out by Jesus to teach. Even Paul was, because he had that mystic vision on the road to Damascus where Jesus told him to convert. Well, didn't quite say it that way. Saul, why do you persecute me? And it follows after that. But in any case, those churches founded by this original group or this central group, they may not even... Of course, they weren't the only original followers of Jesus, but this central group of teachers, the apostles, those churches clearly were founded on the original teaching of Christianity. Those things which were universally taught in these apostolic churches came to form a common tradition by which other teachings could be measured. Among these aspects is a feature called the kerygma, or the officially preached message of the apostles. What is it that the apostles officially preached? You determine this by checking how the churches have interpreted and received that message. And this coincides with consulting those texts which these local communities regarded as being apostolic in their origin. There's no agreement at the time on which texts are apostolic in their origin, but the Church of Antioch will have a list of texts that are read in the churches as apostolic in their origin. This may or may not mean that apostles wrote them. It may mean that they were written by somebody who was a disciple of the apostles. Many churches had Clement of Rome in their list of authoritative apostolic sources, and he is apparently someone who was converted by Paul and placed as a bishop by Paul in Rome. That's how the story goes, but he himself was not an apostle. Mark, of course, is not one of the original apostles, but Mark apparently was a young protege of Peter. Therefore, the Gospel of Mark has that authority with it. And Luke knows, seemingly according to his own claim, the author of Luke knows all of the folks involved in the original Christian movement. So, but these texts don't lead the way. What leads the way is the churches which are known to be apostolic, which are known to be founded by the apostles. Antioch, Jerusalem, Alexandria, Corinth, Ephesus, Rome, all of these churches are apostolic in origin. What is taught there as the official doctrine? When you compare it with the other apostolic churches, you find out, man, it's pretty much the same thing. And then look at their texts, and the texts simply confirm that this is the teaching. In second century writers, it's common for them to refer to the plain and original teaching of the apostles, the kerygma, the official preached message, over against the secret teachings of the Gnostics. The real church is found on plain and original teachings. You'll see this in Irenaeus. Not some type of weird secret teachings that require an unnatural knowledge to understand. From this desire to follow what was handed down, by the way, handing down, to hand down is where we get our word traditio, tradition. From this desire to know what was handed down from the apostles came the related doctrine of the apostolic succession. And this is misunderstood among an awful lot of folks who follow a definition or who are familiar with the Donet definition, which developed later in church history. The concept of apostolic succession in the early church worked this way. The true teachings of Christianity are to be found, they may be found elsewhere, but they are definitely to be found where the Holy Spirit has preserved it, and I should say from the beginning. The true teachings of Christianity are to be found where the Holy Spirit has preserved Christianity from the beginning. The true preachers are those clergy who can trace their ordinations, and by this we mean deacons, priests, bishops, those in the higher order of clergy, the servants of the church, who can trace their ordinations, or some would argue their teachings, directly through a kind of genealogy to specific apostles. Clement, Bishop of Rome, can trace his authority and his ordination to Paul, and possibly to Peter. So we know that Clement is in the apostolic succession. You could make the argument that this concept of tradition refers less to ordination than it does to the teachings being handed down, the actual passing on of the message from one teacher to the next generation of teachers. This could be argued straight out of the book of Timothy in the New Testament, for instance, but the laying on of hands or ordination is there as well. The local bishops of these churches, these ancient churches, are the guardians and keepers of this one true tradition, and hence the concept of the apostolic succession, the passing on of the tradition, the passing on of the ordination, proceeds through the bishops in these churches. And as they ordain bishops of other churches, those bishops are part of the tradition as well. Now, to many of you Protestants and to many of you atheists and agnostics who were brought up in Protestant Sunday school, this is going to sound like Catholicism. However, it is, again, things change over time, folks. This concept of tradition is very much according to the original Lutheran, with the possible exception of an emphasis on ordination or a great emphasis on ordination. It's pretty much the original Lutheran understanding of tradition as it's properly understood. The Protestants did not wage war on tradition. They waged war on error in their own minds. They believed, the big ones anyway, followers of Luther, followers of Calvin, followers of other major Reformed groups, they believed that the true tradition had been obscured by the erroneous tradition of the Pope, also known to some of them as the Antichrist, at least since Gregory the Seventh. Their early popes were saints to the Lutherans as well. They liked Gregory the First quite a bit, for example, but Gregory the Seventh, no. So in Martin Chemnitz, who is a Lutheran bishop of Brandenburg in the 16th century, in his writing called The Examination of the Council of Trent, he has a large section on tradition, what it is, what the true tradition is. And he traces it as the teaching of the apostles, unobscured by arbitrary human opinion, as you'd find among later popes. So ask me questions about this, but this concept of tradition being bad, that's a very new idea. That's an idea that comes with, again, you hear me talk about this a lot, some fringe groups at the time of the Reformation, but it only gains currency, it only gains popularity in the process of that strange 18th century intellectual phenomenon we call the Enlightenment. So let's have a talk on that later. But I always get amused, truly amused, it doesn't go beyond that, I always get amused hearing Christians bash tradition, because frankly, without tradition, there's no Christianity. What is handed on, according to the book of Timothy, the books of Timothy, and Titus, what is handed on is the central message of Christianity, and only later are the texts in which this tradition is articulated marshaled into an authoritative list called the New Testament. Creeds or baptismal formulae. There are a lot of groups of Christians today who say they reject creeds or whatever, having no idea, I think, how creeds actually developed historically. So this also amuses me too. Creeds precede the New Testament canon as well. Even in the first century, there was a tradition of summarizing the faith as a formal ritualized confession, which identified the early Christian communities and separated them from more traditional Jews. Jesus is Lord. That's a formulaic statement, as in 1 Corinthians 12:3. If Jesus is Lord, it rejects the radical Ebionism in which Jesus would only be a prophet. Jesus is Lord is Jesus is Adonai. Jesus is the God of the Old Testament. You can see how Marcion and the Gnostics might not appreciate that. But to confess Jesus as Lord is to confess a formula which rejects those who say Jesus is less than divine. 1 John 4:2. Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. If Jesus Christ has come in the flesh, then it can't be said that Jesus Christ only appeared to have flesh. The words reject radical docetism, or the idea that Jesus only appeared to be human, but was actually just a spiritual being. Docetism may have connections with Gnosticism and some other features of the ancient world, but Gnosticism particularly. But it's what you see in the work you did on Ignatius of Antioch's letter to the Magnesians. There was a concern that certain Christians were saying that Jesus wasn't truly human in the flesh. 1 John 4:2, Christ has come in the flesh, is a confession. It is a ritualized statement that speaks what that group must believe to be part of the group in the early Christian church who believes in Christ. This practice of formal statements of belief that would have to be accepted and repeated by new adherents to the faith was expanded in the second century. Formal outlines of specifically correct teachings would be used to teach those interested in converting, the catechumens, and they would be easily memorized by them and recited thereafter as the confession of faith, or more appropriately, the rule of faith, the canon of faith. The creeds were worded to establish the boundaries of mainline teaching and exclude, without condemning anything specifically, to exclude those ideas which weren't acceptable to the mainline, such as Gnosticism, Docetism, Ebionism, etc. In the second century, creeds were specifically used as measures of belief. Those who did not agree with the creed of the local church, as it was stated, were not to be part of that community. This is the faith of the Church of Rome. And then the creed would be stated. If you disagree with these tenets, you're not, no matter how Christian you may think you are, as a Montanist or a Marcionite, you are not accepted in that community. You do not accept what they believe. These creeds would become the foundation and raw material for what we will learn about, a few weeks from now, to be honest, after spring break, as raw material for the great creed, the so-called Nicene Creed of the 4th century. So hold that thought. The creed of the 4th century is based upon these earlier baptismal formulae. So at baptism, or before baptism, catechumens would be taught, if they were old enough to learn these things, children would learn it later, they would be taught the creed of the local community, such as the creed of the Church of Rome. They would recite it in the process of their baptisms, right before their baptisms, and this would be a confession that they are accepting these things to be true when they receive baptism. Here's an example, the so-called Apostles' Creed, which does not go back to the Apostles. It is the faith of the Apostles. That's how it gets its name. This is the creed of the Church of Rome, certainly in the 3rd century, and I'm not sure how far back it goes. It's been traced to the 2nd. That may be pushing it a bit, I think. But Wolfhard Pannenberg, a lovely name that, Wolfhard Pannenberg has a pretty good exposition of the development of the Apostles' Creed. As it's conjectural, but it's certainly plausible. Here's the creed. Many of you still have it said in your churches. In my church, the Orthodox Church, this creed has been completely replaced by the great creed, the Creed of Nicaea. But we have nothing wrong with this one either. We just don't use it in our church services. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. Note, in saying that, you cannot be a Gnostic or a Marcionite unless you are a liar, because you simply do not believe in the existence, in some cognitive sense, in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. You pistevo, I believe, pistis, the word belief, means more than a mental activity, as we've said before. Pistevo means to accept as true, to accept as reality, to receive the truth of, in a passive sense. And so faith as receptivity. This is what I receive. This is what I do not reject. I do not reject in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. God the Father is the Almighty and the maker of heaven and earth, the source of all things. And in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord. Okay? To be baptized in the Church of Rome, you would confess that Jesus Christ is the only begotten Son of the Father and is our Lord. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord. Now, grammatically, it's interesting. Grammatically, in the creed, the second "and" does not mean that Jesus is not also maker of heaven and earth. He's just in addition to the Father. It can be that Jesus also participates in the making of heaven and earth, and this is clarified in the Great Creed or the Nicene Creed when we see it. Jesus Christ was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. Okay, this actually happened. It didn't appear to happen. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit. He did not have an earthly father. He was born of the Virgin Mary, a woman who had not had sex before his birth. And the early church universally held had not had sex after his birth either. That's something you may ask me about if you like. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried, and he descended into hell. You can ask me about any of those phrases, but taken as a whole, what we have here is a confession or an acknowledgement that all of these things truly happened. These did not appear to happen. These happened to Jesus Christ, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit. God became human through the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered and died, buried, descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. There are certain groups who might reject the resurrection of the flesh, maybe even among Christian communities having inherited that idea from the Sadducees, but it certainly rejects the idea that there is no resurrection of the body from the dead. It rejects all concepts of Gnosticism that see the body as evil and decaying, or Marcionitism that sees the body as not part of the good thing that exists, but part of the evil material world. That Christ goes through this in the flesh means that he's not merely a spiritual being, he's not what the Docetists claim, he had a body, and that body rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. Jesus Christ is Lord, he is powerful, he is in control. To sit at the right hand is to sit at the place of equality, to sit at the place of succession. The difference between Father and Son, according to this creed, is not one of rank, but one of precedence. The Father comes before the Son. We'll talk about this later when we talk about issues with the Trinity. But the Son rises to the place of equality, or succession, next to the Father. Interesting stuff, and deep. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I like using the old King James-ish English here because I just like the phrase, the quick and the dead. Basically, it just means the things that are still moving and the things that ain't. From thence he shall come to judge the things that still have life in them and the things that don't. And this is what is believed about the end times. He will come again, and he will sit as judge. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Lest you think the Holy Spirit is just the cosmic breath, the Holy Spirit is confessed as part of the divine being in this ancient creed. I believe in the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints. You could say the Holy Universal Church or the Holy Church that is established universally means the same thing. But you might as well keep the word Catholic since that's what the word Catholic originally meant. It didn't mean a denomination. And a lot of Lutheran churches, who tend to not think of themselves as Roman Catholic, have reinserted the word Catholic Church in their hymnals because its original meaning should not be lost, they say, and I would say they're right. Being a historian, I like original meanings of things. The communion of saints. Boy, that's a packed phrase. But the idea that the saints are the body of Christ, that this body is united in the communion, in the anamnesis of Christ's death and resurrection, as we talked about in the last lecture. The forgiveness of sins, that's a good thing to believe in, and there are those who don't believe in the forgiveness of sins, but that wouldn't form a heresy so much as something that catechumens accept when they accept the Christian movement. The resurrection of the body. As Christ's body was raised from the dead, so also your body will be raised from the dead, contra Marcion, against the Gnostics. This body is a good thing that God made, that God had one of himself when he became human, and this body will be raised from the dead also. And life everlasting, amen. In other words, after the resurrection of the dead, the soul continues with the body to live forever. Amen, this is most certainly true, is what that means. So when you Lutherans remembered memorizing the catechism and so many things end with this is most certainly true, that's the real meaning of amen. Certainly, of a certainty. No question about it. So, prior to baptism, the new converts into the parishes of the Church of Rome, by Church of Rome I don't mean Roman Catholic, that's a later usage, but simply the church that is in Rome, the city. Those who are about to be baptized would speak this because they mean it, and this would be their measure of what the truth is from then on. And then the third piece of the reaction against the three kind of great fields of heresy, the Marcionites, the Gnostics, and the Montanists, is the development of an authoritative list, or a group of authoritative lists, which eventually over time congeals into what we think of as the New Testament. Canon, again, in this case, a guideline or an authoritative list. So there are different canons. The Muratorian canon, for example, is a list of books that were considered authoritative. And there were many of these lists. We have a few of them that can be reconstructed or that we've recovered that show which books were considered authorities in various local churches. Over against the list of Marcion, who first developed this idea of a list of books which were the only acceptable ones, and the practice of picking and choosing authorities by the Gnostics, the Proto-Orthodox developed their own list of those books which were considered to be the true authorities for Christian teaching. These authorities were added to those books which were already considered authorities, the books of the Old Testament, as we now call it, or the books of the Hebrew or Jewish scriptures, and which comprise the books of the Old Testament, the lesser authorities known as the Apocrypha, over which there was no debate. The Old Testament and the Apocrypha were taken from the official books of the synagogue. They inherited from the Jewish synagogue. The Christian synagogues inherited the authoritative concept of, or the concept of the authoritative library of books. Particularly, this list was solidified in the Greek translation of the Hebrew scriptures known as the Septuagint. Ask me about any of these things. I want to clarify a couple as we're moving through. I hear students talk about occasionally how the Catholics have a larger Bible, or the Protestants, Catholic students will talk about Protestants removing books from the Bible. Oh boy, that never happened. None of it. Actually, in its origin, the Hebrew scriptures, some of which the later scriptures were written in Aramaic and some of the apocryphal books were written in Greek, the Apocrypha is more properly called the Deuterocanon. We can talk about these names and what they mean, or the secondary canon. There's a primary canon, which is the most authoritative books of the Jewish library. And then there is a secondary canon written in the gap years, primarily after the return to Jerusalem and before the developments that we associate with rabbinic Judaism. Truth to tell, all Bibles, whether they were produced by Protestants or Catholics, had all of these books in them at the time of the Reformation. The Apocrypha dropped out of Bibles in Protestant lands, not because they didn't have a certain authority, though a lesser authority than the other books of the Old Testament, but because it was cheaper to print without them. One of the first Protestant Bibles to lack the Apocrypha, these secondary books such as Tobit, Bell and the Dragon, one of my favorites, actually Tobit's probably my very favorite, the books of the Maccabees, the Wisdom of Jesus ben Sirach, all of these were authorities, though not as authoritative as the other books, for everyone. In the 17th century, for the first time, a Protestant Bible was printed without the Apocrypha for savings of cost. We'll only use the best books, and we'll leave these secondary books out. Ironically, this happened, and the table of contents still had, or the index, as it was called at the time, still had the books of the Apocrypha listed in it. They were just not printed. It cost money to print, and it, you know, used extra paper. This, and only here at that time, did the habit just slowly begin of not including these books. And most of your Bibles today, if they're not produced by the Catholic or the Orthodox churches, tend not to have the Apocrypha in them. But Martin Luther quoted from the Apocrypha as a secondary, not as a primary authoritative source, and you see this among other Protestant leaders as well. Long into the 19th century, family Bibles in Lutheran lands contained the Apocrypha. So ask me about this further, but I want to at least raise that for the sake of discussion, that's what's going on with these so-called shorter and longer Bibles. There's a lot of nonsense going on out there in campus discussion that I overhear. So bring it to me. Let's sort it out. The Septuagint, by the way, is the official Greek translation of the Old Testament. Sometimes it's clear that words that Christ is quoting from the Old Testament or attributed to Christ in the New Testament are quoted from the Septuagint, and sometimes they're from the Hebrew. We can tell the difference by how things are quoted. But it's no big deal. The Septuagint is just the Greek translation of what y'all call the Old Testament plus Apocrypha. In the course of the 2nd through the early 4th centuries, a consensus developed. Note the use of that word consensus. It's very important. A consensus slowly developed on what were the authoritative books from the apostolic times, what we call the New Testament. Contrary to the Da Vinci Code and a shocking number of supposedly educated theologians and historians, there was no council at which the books were officially chosen. Not at Nicaea, not at the Council of Carthage, or anywhere else. There was no council which officially chose or voted on the books of the New Testament. For instance, the PBS special, Banned from the Bible, suggests that the books were selected at the Council of Nicaea. Horrible, horrible, horrible interpretation of history. The truth is much more fluid. Ironically, we don't think of people in the 16th century as knowing as much about the early church as we do now, because we've had archaeology and new textual finds which help. But this was known, for instance, to Luther, that there wasn't really any vote taken on the New Testament. So that throws out an awful lot of the mythology I'm hearing across campus of Constantine insisted these books be included or those books not be included. Far as I know, Constantine slept through the damn Council of Nicaea. It's only Eusebius, his biographer, which makes him the hero of the council. I'm sure he was busy plotting to strangle his family, which Constantine did. He really just wanted the church to sort out its issues. What do these councils do? These councils do mention authoritative books which have been received in various communities. They merely agreed that the lists, which had come down by common consensus from the 2nd and 3rd centuries, were fine lists. Yup. Those will do just fine. It so happens that an awful lot of the books of the Bible, your official text, never were accepted by certain regional churches. I've mentioned before just in passing in class, but no, the Church of Syria has never accepted that creepy book of Revelation which you've got stuck on the back of your Bible. And in fact, it was not required of pastors in churches to accept books which were not universally accepted. As late as the 19th century, a Lutheran pastor by the name of C.F.W. Walther comes to the aid of another Lutheran pastor who does not accept the book of Revelation as scripture. His parish, his congregation is livid. You've got to accept the whole Bible, they say. C.F.W. Walther, who is really the president of what develops into the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, C.F.W. Walther says there's no reason he has to accept the book of Revelation. It's not universally accepted by the church. The point I'm making is that the New Testament canon, since it's not a matter of vote, is a canon which just congeals around certain principles, which I'm going to discuss in the next slide. Also counter to the code, Da Vinci Code that is, and much current popular nonsense, there was not a host of books which were rejected. Bart Ehrman slams this in his book, which I think he wrote in his socks at the breakfast table, but he did a brilliant job. He did a book in a response to the Da Vinci Code, where he just nails these popular myths that have grown up over time. There are not a host of books which were rejected. There simply isn't that much writing to reject. And of the books which were on some canons, such as the Didache or First Clement, and slipped off of those canons over time, when you read these books, they are shockingly similar to what's in the New Testament. The Gnostic Gospels were never considered by any mainline Christians as being true Gospels. The Book of Clement was considered by a wide variety of Christians to be inspired and still could be considered inspired to this day, but it didn't meet the criteria of what is true apostolic scripture. The way in which the books were chosen meant that there was remarkable little variation in the lists among the proto-Orthodox communities throughout the empire. There's overlap, there are some books present and some absent, but let's see how this happened. So the general criteria for the canon. To be in the canon of the New Testament, to be in the official list of what becomes the New Testament, they never called it the New Testament, they called it the canon. It had to have, a book had to have apostolic authority, which means you had to establish a link to the apostles. The question in recognizing the authoritative books was one of determining which represented the original teaching of the apostles. Only those books which were recognized as either being authored by the original apostles, including Paul, or having the authority of the apostles in their production, as in Mark and Luke, were acceptable. Clement, or First Clement, although it's written by a disciple of Paul, and if you read it, you say, my gosh, he's just saying all the stuff Paul said, sometimes a little more eloquently. Paul didn't have a hand in its production, I guess. These criteria are always a bit fluid, and apparently they were not. There's plenty of room for leeway in the second and third centuries. The list gets narrowed in the fourth. Bruce Metzger, who I have mentioned before, as one of the more significant figures in biblical scholarship in the 20th century, made the argument, which I personally agree with, and you should pursue it in class if you like. He made the argument that the criteria for being in the New Testament was not whether or not something was inspired. First Clement was considered to have the same, you know, influence of the Holy Spirit that, say, Colossians did, but it was not sufficiently apostolic. Interesting thought. Another criteria for the canon is the concept of the tradition of use. To determine which texts were apostolic in origin in the local traditions of the earliest community, the local traditions of the earliest communities were considered. In other words, in the apostolic communities, in those communities founded by the apostles, what are they reading? Those books which were widely in use in the original communities, which means read in the liturgy. Now, there are many texts and scriptures from those early centuries which are not read in the liturgy. They could be considered early Christian popular literature. Those books which were widely in use in the original communities, read in the liturgy, made it into most of the early canons. In this way, the so-called Bible, and you know I don't like that term, the scriptures of the New Testament, were determined by a consideration of tradition more than anything else. If a book could conceivably have been written by Paul, let's say the Didache, or parts of it, were written by Paul, but if it's not clearly in use in the ancient apostolic churches, it doesn't matter who wrote it, because it's the tradition of the churches that determines the authority of the books. While the final form of this list is only set in the 4th century, again by consensus, not vote, the criteria here clearly eliminate most of the interesting candidates for other Gospels or biblical books. None of the Gnostic Gospels could ever measure up to the basic concept that they had to agree with the Apostles' teaching, much less be written by or produced under the authority of an Apostle. None of them were read in mainline apostolic churches, and frankly, the dang books contradict the books that were read in traditional churches. You'll read them yourselves, and you'll see what I mean. So, the big shocking debate, we found the Gospel of Judas. Could it be one of the original Gospels? The answer's no. The form we have it was written in the 4th century, not the 1st. The form we have it clearly contradicts the other scriptures, and the form we have it was a Gnostic scripture and never would have been considered by the proto-Orthodox at all for inclusion in anything. It was an obnoxious anti-gospel which made the God of the Old Testament evil and made Jesus Christ a weird, well, you'll read it for yourself. It gets better. The Gnostic texts were not in use in mainline churches, and more significantly, they were clearly produced in the 2nd century or later. Sorry, Dan Brown. The study of what got in and why, and what didn't, is still fascinating. I'm going to be putting a link on the Moodle webpage when my regular webpage gets up and running or stays up and running, depending on when you're listening to this lecture. You'll be able to link to it there, too. There's a fellow on the web who's done a neat graph of which books are read in which communities in the ancient church. The next three slides just kind of round out some important ideas that are necessary for the sake of the first test. I've got a slide here relating to Chapter 7 in Williston Walker. For those of you who may be listening to this recording who aren't in the class because this stuff's getting posted on YouTube, I'm fine with you listening to it. Keep in mind that I'm treating it as I would a classroom lecture. I don't have a scripted anything, which is why I stumble over myself verbally. I am recording this sometime in the middle of the night when the wolves are out. In this northern Minnesota shack where I do my work. And you're welcome to listen and distribute them, but be charitable and realize that I'm simply recording them as I would a lecture in classroom. And a misspeak here or there, I beg your forgiveness. And that's just what happens when you're going for two straight hours on a lecture style recording. So that explains, if you've stumbled across this, why I have a slide called A Few Points to Note on Chapter 7. This is Chapter 7 in the fourth edition of Williston Walker's History of the Christian Church, which frankly, until somebody comes out with something as detailed without grinding all kinds of nasty axes for their personal biases, I'll switch to that book. Until then, we're stuck with what we've got, a 1985 textbook, which is still the most detailed out there. Chapter 7 deals with the so-called interpretation of Jesus. Be careful of that, because Chapter 7 is also written at a period of time when interpreting Jesus an awful lot of ahistorical stuff was being read backward into history. But there are a few things I want to point out about the use of two church fathers, two ancient church authorities, one in particular, but also another, Tertullian and Cyprian, or Cyprian. Tertullian, we've talked about before. Cyprian, Bishop of Carthage, you can tell it's getting later and later. These represent the first truly Western, that should probably be in quotation marks, and Latin interpreters of Christianity. That's why the textbook's keen on them. It's written by Western Christians. I, as you know, or have guessed if I haven't stated it plainly enough, am an Eastern Christian. But Tertullian and Cyprian represent the first truly Western and Latin interpreters of Christianity. Prior to this, Christianity is an intensely Greek-speaking and Aramaic-speaking phenomenon. The North African church, of which they were both a part, was shaped by the intense persecutions there, and hence the concept of martyrdom is explored far more fully by them as a theological category than anywhere else at this time period. Also note, when I say Western, what we're really talking about is North African and things west of the Italian peninsula. So we are not talking about Rome at this point as a Western Christian phenomenon. The bishops of Rome through the second century into the third wrote and spoke in Greek primarily. Latin was an official language which they would have known, but Greek would be the language of daily conversation. North Africa tended not to be. And so when we talk about Latin Christianity, it really begins with Tertullian and the Bishop Cyprian. Western Christianity has a far more categorical and legal approach to Christian teachings, which begins with Tertullian, partly because the guy's a lawyer, and lawyers tend to talk in terms of legal categories. Laws are laws, categories are categories, classifications of things are strict, or stricter than they are in non-legal types of speech. For Tertullian, especially after his conversion to Montanism, or in his conversion to Montanism, this meant a more austere moral life a life lived by law more than canon, canon being guideline, law being a rule or a regula. The definitions overlap, but the concept we have in the West today of law is far more rigid than the concept of canon in the East. And a firm rejection of pagan philosophy. This is unique, really, to Tertullian. Other church fathers, contrary to the ahistorical and uninformed writings of Charles Freeman, ask me about Charles Freeman in class. His books are very popular and not very well researched. They're written with a lot of axe grinding and not a lot of information. But Tertullian is really the most vehement opponent of pagan philosophy, and yet this is as much as anything, you know, a rhetorical distancing of his position from pagan conclusions than it is a true rejection of pagan philosophy. A lot of work has been done on this. It's not a clear-cut issue between pagans and Christians, as Robert Louis Wilkin points out in his work, which I recommend to your reading, the Christians as the pagans saw them, the Christians as the Romans saw them. So check that one out for a little bit of clarification on folks like our early church fathers. So when people are looking to bash Christians because they rejected pagan philosophy, well, most didn't, or most accepted it in a qualified way, even as most pagans accepted pagan philosophy in a qualified way. It was very mainline. Tertullian's on the extreme edge, perhaps. Part of the legalistic nature, or of the language, or the neat legalistic nature of the writings for Tertullian and Cyprian is the categorical nature of the Latin language. Greek is more fluid. It's precise, but it's more verbal. It's less nominal than Latin. Latin is far more specific. It's far more what you might think of as literal in a language. I've mentioned there's not really a word for literal in Greek and Hebrew, but ad literam, according to the letters, is how you can use the word literal in Latin. Still doesn't mean quite the rigid definition that we have of the word literal today, but Latin is more categorical, more precise in a noun sense than Greek, and it forces a kind of legal sense of law and sense of rigidity into the discussion of Christianity in Latin. This is something that Augustine later, we'll talk about Augustine and after test two. This is something that Augustine, who only writes in Latin and probably only knows Latin, really wrestles with because he finds it difficult to convey the complexity of Christian teaching in the Latin language. I think Greek is easier, but of course you know my biases. As soon as Christianity is translated into Latin, differences begin to emerge in the interpretations of the East and West. This is not significant, and it's more a matter of emphasis, different way of pronouncing emphasis for those of you who missed it. It's more of a matter of emphasis than anything else. The differences between Latin and Greek discourse on Christianity don't become critical for a few centuries, but language is a major issue in the breakup between the Latin or Western Church in the Middle Ages and the Greek or Eastern Church. By Latin, we mean the language used in West, and by Greek, we don't mean it's filled with Greeks, but we mean that is the language of the people. Eventually, Tertullian would slip over the rigorous, or you might call it legalistic, edge into the heresy of Montanism. This has more to do with Tertullian's personality than anything else, I believe. I would encourage you to read very carefully. The book is correct, and frequently the book isn't correct, and I will be spending time, to the extent that I haven't already, correcting the book in class. I won't get all the errors, but I'll at least give you a sampling so you remember to read carefully. Here, though, they say something that's really rather correct, but it can be misunderstood. The books claim that Tertullian provides the first systematic treatment of the so-called Trinity does not mean the idea of a threeness in God or a Trinity began with Tertullian. He's just the first to logically dice it out, hold on to that thought, and I'll demonstrate more on this in part two after the first test, when we get into the early issues how can God be three. Several different groups tried to sort this out in the 3rd century, but Tertullian is the one who gives it a logical structure. It's not a logical structure which is still accepted or was even widely accepted at the time. So just a caveat lector. Reader, beware. Don't overinterpret the book at this point. What it says is correct, but don't read into it the idea that, you know, say, threeness in divinity is new with Tertullian. The scholar Oscar Skarsson, I don't think I've ever pronounced his last name correctly and won't claim to now, but he wrote the book in the Shadow of the Temple, teaches at a Lutheran seminary, is really a very well-read student of Second Temple Judaism, points out that there is a threeness in the discourse in Greek among certain Greek-speaking Jews prior to Christ as well. How this evolves is a subtle thing, so just hold off, don't leap to conclusions. Now a little introduction to the second great apologist, Justin Martyr. I have not introduced in this lecture because I will be introducing him in class and we will be reading him in class. But Irenaeus of Lugdunum, great name that is now Lyon in France. He was born around 115, died possibly as late as the year 202, though death dates for Irenaeus are in debate. He spent his boyhood in Smyrna, in Asia Minor, one of the ancient churches in Asia Minor, and was old already that by the time he was born, because the church in Smyrna was in existence very early in the Christian movement. He probably knew the celebrated Bishop Polycarp there. We'll get into this more when we read the writings of Irenaeus and say, you know, what was his relation to Polycarp, but there would have been an overlap between Irenaeus and Polycarp from what we can tell. He studied and taught in Rome before being sent to Lugdunum, the Roman city in Gaul, as a presbyter. That's the level of clergy that we now tend to call priest, though, you know, I prefer the term presbyter because that's what it is in Greek, opa. The Christian community in Lugdunum was primarily a Greek-speaking group of merchants and artisans. Irenaeus is then very clearly an Eastern church father. The churches in what we now call France, what is then Gaul, tended to have a real affinity, or we could call them the Celtic churches, though I don't want to open up the can of worms on what a Celt is. The Celtic churches tend to have a real affinity long into the 5th and 6th centuries for the more Eastern or the more Greek approach to Christianity. We'll see this in the reception of Augustine's teachings in Gaul. Augustine's teachings are received, but with a certain qualification by bishops in Gaul, certain bishops in Gaul, who object that Greek thought in early Christianity should be followed rather than Augustine's formulaic approach. More on that later. Irenaeus was absent in Asia Minor, this section of land that we now roughly call Turkey. He was absent in Asia Minor, not Rome, as the book says, in the year 177, when a fierce local persecution back in his parish in Lugdunum killed the then bishop in Lugdunum or Lyon. Somewhat ironically, Irenaeus appears to have been in Asia Minor, urging a tolerant stance toward the heresy of Montanism. Now, Irenaeus is known as a fierce opponent of heresy, but he wants the Montanists because they do believe in Christ, because they do accept the basic teachings of the apostles. They should not be treated as harshly as the more dangerous crowd of Gnostics are. When I say treated, keep in mind we're not in a position here in the second century where the church has any power to persecute anybody. It's just, how do you get along with them? Are they accepted in your churches? Well, the Montanists are not, but they're not as nasty as the Gnostics who are actively trying to betray you. hierarchy and authority and discipline in the early church mean specifically this: if you are accepted into the community, or if you are essentially asked to leave because you have wandered from the community. So a tolerant attitude doesn't imply persecution of Montanists. It simply implies that we should listen to them and reason with them, possibly bring them back into the fold of the proto-Orthodox movement. When he returned to Lugdunum, because the old bishop had died in the persecution there, he was made the new bishop by the church in Lugdunum. So he came back and was made into the overseer of the church. Apparently, according to Irenaeus, this persecution in 177, which killed so many Christians, was facilitated by the Gnostics in their midst, these fake Christians, as Irenaeus sees them. Unlike the Montanists, the Gnostics are dead wrong about everything, and they are vicious and nasty people who turned in Christians, who ensured that Christians were killed by the authorities in the year 177. So there's a personal grudge here. Now, Irenaeus is not interested in vengeance. He's interested in ensuring that the church is protected from these nasty individuals in the future. The center of Irenaeus' theology, and we'll get into this more when we read the first book against heresies and sections from other of his books against heresies. The central doctrine is the teaching that Christ restores, and the word that's usually used or translated is recapitulates, restores the original order to, the original head to. Christ restores the original intended perfection of all creation in himself. Hold on to this, because what we mean when I say all of Christian doctrine comes down to two questions: who is Jesus Christ and what did he come to do? Certainly these are answered clearly in chapters 8 and 9 of the book of Mark when we read it, but that doesn't mean that the way that was interpreted, he is the Christ, and he came to suffer and die and rise again, it doesn't mean that that's interpreted then the way Christians tend to interpret it now. Irenaeus would say, yup, that's it. He is the Christ. He came to suffer, to die, and to rise again. But in doing so, what he was really doing was restoring the original intended perfection of all creation and setting the stage for a period where all of the good things, all of the beautiful things of the created world would be restored to what God wanted originally. Hold on to that idea and ask me questions. Humans are saved. He would not use that word, and I'll explain why as we get into it. That sense of past tense saved is not original in early Christianity. Humans are brought into, and that's why I use the word saved, they are brought into reconciliation with God through being made one with and being made like Christ. The word that also often gets thrown around is deified, made divine, by a life of union with Christ, who is God. Humans are saved by being made one with and like Christ. Okay? This is interesting because a lot of modern Christian discussions have dropped off the idea of what salvation really means. For Irenaeus, it means union with Christ. It doesn't mean Jesus just looking the other way for your sins and saying, oh heck, you're a sinful piece of crud, go into heaven anyway. That kind of shallow, one-dimensional view of what Christ did is not to be found in early Christian writings. It gets pretty complex, and you Christians are in for a real ride when we get into Irenaeus. And for that matter, you've been on a ride already. Justin Martyr also. None of the teachings of Irenaeus originated with him. I will make that claim because I had a special graduate seminar taught by a really sharp Irenaeus scholar, Bill Weinrich, at my Lutheran seminary. None of the teachings of Irenaeus originated with him, but he was the one who most clearly set them forth in writing. and his writings became a standard authority for both East and West in the next centuries. His texts were very widely distributed across the known world, within and even outside of the Roman Empire. They were extremely influential books in the late classical period and into the early Middle Ages. And this you should know, because if you're looking for a writer who epitomizes kind of the standard of belief of the early church, Irenaeus is a good one. A little more on Irenaeus, then we'll call it a night. I know, these nights are getting long, but you have a pause button, and I don't. I have a cup of tea that's running short. Part of Irenaeus's influence comes from his thorough discussion of and attack on the two groups, the Gnostics and the Marcionites. Notice he leaves the Montanists out because they have to be dealt with differently. This five-volume set was originally entitled, and this is a good one, it's a mouthful, An Indictment and Overthrow of Knowledge Falsely So-Called. Wow. Mercifully, this was shortened to Against Heresies in later Latin translations, and that's how we refer to it now. Until very recent finds of texts in Egypt and a few other locations, Irenaeus was the source which provided the only thorough image of what Gnosticism was and what it taught. He is still extremely valuable, as almost everything we have discovered supports, to some degree, the accuracy of his account, if it also reveals his biases. Obviously, the Gnostics are not going to think of themselves in such negative terms as Irenaeus does. Irenaeus is his name, and it may be ironic once you read the type of his writing you have. His name means peace, or the peaceful one. But Irenaeus is viciously opposed to the Gnostics. He doesn't want to hurt them. He does want to expose them for the nasty frauds that they are, and his language is quite strong. These people are deadly. They are dangerous. They are corrupt. They are guilty of spiritual adultery for what they have done. We'll get into more language when we read the text. Biases he does have. After all, he believes they killed his bishop. His other major work, called The Proof of the Apostolic Preaching, was also read throughout the Roman Empire, and if anything, distributed and read more widely than Against Heresies. Though this text, influential as it was lost to modern scholars until 1904. And this was quite a find, I tell you. I wasn't there. Don't get me wrong. In this one, he demonstrates the continuity of Judaism and Christianity through a very traditional, by his day, Christian reading of the Old Testament. So if you're wondering how Christians in the early church, particularly within 200 years of Christ, were reading the Old Testament, and Irenaeus is very traditional in his reading of the Old Testament, this is a window into that. There is some real debate over when Irenaeus died among scholars who have way too much time on their hands. We have no way of absolutely telling for sure, so let's make sure we write about it a lot. I gotta shovel snow. I've got 1,000 things to do other than debate when Irenaeus died. Whether it was at the end of the 2nd century or the beginning of the 3rd, it was a martyr's death. And there is good reason, as he says of the bishop who was killed before him, to believe that he was turned in or betrayed to the authorities by some local Gnostics who used the opportunity to eliminate a rival. We gotta call it quits there, because I am just out of steam. And this covers most of the material that you'll need prior to the second test. Everything else will be in class, or prior to the first test, I'm sorry. Everything else will be in class. The reading of Irenaeus's actual Books Against Heresies will be done after the first test, because that's just the most convenient way to do it. This way, at least, you have an idea who he is. He's in this set of slides because, like Justin the Martyr, he's one of the apologists. And this is the Age of the Apologists. We don't study the apologists generally in this set of slides or lectures. What we study is the environment in which they lived. Justin Martyr, of course, will be reading in class. Thank you very much. I hope you've endured this well, and without further discussion, there will be another lecture coming your way someday, and I'll see you in class. Take care.